Father God, we thank you for your goodness. God, we thank you that you are the God of gods, the God above all others, the God above the heavens, seated above the cherubim. Lord, we thank you that you are to be exalted above any power, principality, king, ruler, authority. Lord, you are sovereign. And we thank you for your choice of us. Lord, we don't understand it. We don't deserve it, certainly. But Lord, we can thank you for it. And we can continually be in your debt and gratitude and continue to work to show ourselves as a worker approved by you. And God, we ask that you would help us as we divide the word tonight, as we look at your word and look at complicated passages and talk about some deeper things, that you would help us to keep our eyes focused on you and on your sovereignty. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Okay, so last week we opened up a can of worms, and there wasn't a whole lot of folks here to enjoy those worms, so I'll try to give us a nutshell of where we landed. So, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. Elohim is the generic term for a divine being. Okay? Now, I'm just putting that out there. Elohim, if you have Mormon friends, if you know anybody in Mormonism, they would tell you that Elohim's the name of God. And they're wrong. It's not. In their religion, it is. It's the name of a guy who lived on another planet, was a good Mormon, and then inherited Earth and became Earth's God. And that's his name, Elohim. I'm just telling you what they say. And if you're a good Mormon, you can inherit your own planet one day and be God there. What an American religion, right? Whew. Born and raised here, and all you got to do is just be good, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, and you can be God one day. Anyway, that's a whole nother rabbit trail in cults and false religions. But when we look in the Bible and we see the Hebrew word Elohim, the word that is normally translated in our English Bibles as God, it's a very different word than what our English word for God is. When we say in English, God, if we have a capital G on it, what does it mean? The one monotheistic God, okay? So the God of the Abrahamic religions. That's like Webster's definition. Capital G God is the God of the Abrahamic religions, okay? And we're good with that. Little G God, what's that? Idols, other gods that are out there. And in our kind of, in the way I learned it when I was growing up, monotheism. What's monotheism mean? There's only one God. There's only one God. And so you would say, oh yeah, but there's no other gods except for this one true God. And that is right. That is true. That is good. But if I was to speak to an ancient Israelite and say, so does that mean that there's only one Elohim? They would say, well, of course not. Of course not. There's way more than one Elohim. There's all kinds of Elohim out there. How else could it be said that God is the God of all Elohim? If he's the only one, we would just say that he's the only one. And so this makes people uncomfortable, right? It kind of gives everybody a little bit of a pause to go, wait a second, are you telling me that there's other gods out there? That's why I don't like using the G word, because it's confusing. Because, no, there's not other gods, but there are other spiritual beings. And that's that word Elohim. That's just the generic term for a spiritual being. And if I asked you, are there other spiritual beings and spiritual forces at power in the world? Of course, yes, we all say, of course there are. There's demons and there's angels and all kinds of spiritual stuff going on. Okay, so I'm saying nothing controversial. I'm just trying to put it in the words that our Hebrew Bible and our English Bible say it. We looked last week at the story of, looked at the account of creation and how we see that in Genesis chapter 1, there is no mention of a personal name of this Elohim that created all these things, who filled the earth with goodness, who ordered and organized everything. There's no personal name listed. You read through every account that you see there in Genesis 1. It's God created, which is Elohim created. And Elohim is actually a plural noun, which further confuses people, because then you're like, so should it be translated gods did this? No, because every verb that's attached to it, God created, Elohim created, every verb is actually singular. They use a plural noun with a singular verb, which is definitely a choice. Like, the author of Genesis was not a fool, right? He's not going, oh, I made a grammatical error every time I said God did something. God created, God said, God called, God did this. Anytime there's a God there, it's a plural noun with a singular verb, which is the author's way of saying there is one Elohim who is greater than all Elohim. And then he gets through chapter 1, and then at the beginning of chapter 2, we finally see the retelling of the account of creation, the retelling of the story from a different perspective, a different angle. And there we see who that one Elohim is, and it is Yahweh Elohim, the Lord God. Okay, and so there's a definition that's there. It's almost like the author was going through the first chapter in order to kind of build this tension of who are we talking about? Who is this? And of course, every good Hebrew would have already known it as they're reading and they worship the one true and living God. They know who it is. But if you're the first time you're picking it up, if you were a 10-year-old and you're reading the Hebrew Bible and you've never heard any of this before, it's just totally fresh in your mind, you're reading, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. Like, the gods created the gods, he create the heavens? That doesn't make any sense. There's some confusion that's there. And this confusion gets cleared up as you keep reading. So it's like they're pushing you towards continuing. Keep reading. And it's guiding you in that direction. Okay, so that was pretty much where we were at last week. We talked about how there are other things there in Genesis chapter 1. If you go down into Genesis chapter 1, there in verse 14, you start to see the creation of the lights, heavenly lights, the sun, moon, and the stars. And in the ancient imagination, the ancient understanding of the cosmos, you had a three-layered order of the universe. You have the waters above, the waters beneath, and the earth, the land. Okay, there's three-layer cosmology, and in the waters above, you have populated with stars, lights. And they saw those as spiritual beings. We today look with a telescope and we see balls of gas burning millions of light years away. And I've posited that both of those things can be true. I'm not saying that that ball of gas is actually a spiritual being, but I'm saying that there's a spiritual reality that they were tapping into in understanding that we live in a world that is populated not just with physical reality, but with spiritual reality. And so they're speaking on a different wavelength than we are. Okay, so that was where we were at. Just because I threw all that at you and only two of y'all were here from last week, I want to open it up if there's any questions that you might have from that or push back, you want to talk about it a little bit more. Yep. I did. So Genesis 1 there's nothing of the Trinity yet, okay? As we're here, this is something that's going to unfold as we go. And so over the next few weeks, we're looking at the idea of spiritual beings and God and all of this. We're going to get there. That's the end point, but I don't want to open up... I don't want to open up a theology textbook and just be like, Trinity, and then find all the verses that talk about Trinity. Because I feel like whenever we look and it says, you know, and God said, let there be light, and we go, oh, that's plural, so that must be the Trinity. Or when we read in verse 26, then God said, let us make man. And, oh, us, that's the Trinity. We want to go there. And I think you're right. I think that's a good thing. But let's not read the end of the story to the beginning first, okay? Let's look at it as the biblical authors and the you know, ancient Israelites who were reading this would have seen it. They would have looked at it, and they would have naturally had some questions. That's my wife. I can't stand it. I'm like, how did you just ruined the whole thing? You just read the end of the book there, and you know the ending, and you're don't spoil it. So, anyway. Yes, ma'am. A progressive revelation. We've talked about that. We talked about that back when we were talking about revelation, talking about how God speaks. He reveals himself over time through human interaction over a period of time. So there's a levels of understanding. And so if we read in Samuel and expect everything to be, you know, looking like it does in Revelation, you know, we're setting ourselves up for failure and confusion because there is a progressive revelation that goes through the whole thing. There's one author. One author, it's all pointing to Christ as the main focus of the Scriptures. But it's written by human authors carried along by the Holy Spirit, right? And so they're given the ability to write and the you know, content to write in their own words with their own abilities and the level of understanding that they have. Okay, so that there is a working through of Scripture in that way. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Elohim. Yep. Verse 4. Yep. Yep. Once you get to verse 4, I think that should be Genesis chapter 2. Okay, Genesis chapter 2, verse 4 is actually the first verse of the second movement of Genesis. Yeah, I don't know why it was chosen in the 1600s that chapter 1 would continue going on a little bit, but, you know. I was just, hey, we've got time, we're here, but like the chapter numbers are not something that is inspired. That's not something that was, you know, Moses didn't write this down and go, okay, here's the end of chapter 1. Turn the page, all right, lick the thing, and here's chapter 2. Let's start going. This was something added in later so that we could find things a little bit easier. But yeah, whenever you're looking at just the movements of creation, starting in chapter 2, verse 4, now you have a new retelling of creation, and as we said last week, it's a completely different retelling. Like, it doesn't even line up. Like, you try to look at both of them side by side, and you're going, this doesn't make any sense. You've got now man being like the first thing that's created in the second telling, but he was the very end of everything in the first. How does this work? It's because the author's not focused on trying to give us a play-by-play, you know, view of what's happening. Instead, he's trying to tell a bigger story, a larger story about what's happening. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. That is Elohim. Yep. Generally speaking, when you see the English word God, it is the word Elohim. It's almost a one-to-one translation. There are a handful of little spots where it's not. But what I'm trying to tell you is that Elohim can mean more than just big G, the one true God, right? We see we're in Exodus, and we're talking about how, you know, how God Yahweh God is going to get over on Pharaoh and the little g gods of Egypt, right? He's going to show who he is, and he's going to prove himself to be supreme over the little g gods. Well, that's still the word Elohim, but it's a massively different understanding of who these creatures, beings are. Spiritual being, yeah. Yep. So it's a generic term, but it's a generic term in the way that we can use other generic terms. Like if I was to walk into someone's house and they've got I walk into Jason and Amy's house and I talk to Malachi and I say, "Hey, where's mom?" Malachi knows who I'm talking about, right? Even though there are millions of moms, right? There's whole lots of moms, but there's one mom that's his mom, right? And I don't have to say your mom. I can just say, "Where's mom?" And he knows because of the relationship that's there. It's the same way with Elohim. When you know the one true and living God, you don't have to say him by name. You can just say God, and you know who you're talking about. If we're in our meeting here and I say God, I don't have to clarify and go, "Hey, I'm not talking about Moloch or this one or other gods. I'm talking about Yahweh," right? I don't have to do that because we know who our God is. And that's the point whenever we get into verses like the Shema, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." The Lord, our God, hear that? Yahweh, our Elohim, is one. He's alone. He's all by himself. Not that there's no other, but that he is the greatest. He is above all. Okay? And we didn't go here last week, but let me share a couple of verses with you that talk about it that way. Go to Psalm 108, verse 5. And feel free, if you've got other questions and stuff as we're looking at these, we can certainly pause and talk about them. So, the entire Bible, yeah. Forty authors, yeah. and consistency within the narrative, right? There's even in interesting things like this where you might expect one author to handle it one way and another do another, there's a consistency across the board, which is what we're going to look at tonight. So it's very, very interesting. But you can see the change throughout time because they're writing this over 1,500 years. What did English look like 1,500 years ago? Massively different. I don't write like William Shakespeare did. And William Shakespeare was only, 1,000 years, less than 1,000 years, 500 years. So, okay, I mean, we're talking three times that much. Anyway, so yeah, it's amazing that we have the kind of consistency that we do, and they're writing across three different languages, okay? So anyway, Psalm chapter 8, verse 5, hear this. "Be exalted, O God, above the heavens." Okay, so remember the three-layer cosmology that's there with the waters above, waters beneath, and the earth, the land. Okay, you can almost, as Daniel said last week, think of it like a flat earth idea. The earth floating on the disk of the chaotic waters, and then the dome of the skies, the waters above that broke open with rain and all of that, the fountains of the deep and the windows of heaven, right? There's this idea of what the universe is like in the ancient mind. And we can't look at them and go, "Oh, how simple are they? How did they not know?" You wouldn't know either had somebody not told you, right? Like, none of us figured this out on our own, right? I didn't figure out that we're on a spinning, space rock flying through space at, however many, 1,000 miles an hour. That's been stuff that's been told to me. I've been taught that. Same thing with them. They were taught that this is their cosmology. So we can't blame them for it. It's not a wrong thing or a bad thing. One is just focused in one direction, the other one's focused in a different direction. Okay? So when we see here in this three-layered cosmology, where again do the spiritual beings reside? What layer do they fill up? Up. Yeah, they're in the skies. In the heavens is the fancy, you know, Bible word we'd like to say, but it literally is just the word skies. Hamaim. Okay? So you've got the skies, the waters above. And so all of the stars, the sun, the moon, they populate this realm above us, just like the animals and people populate the realm that we are here. And you've got some crazy, weird creatures that populate the waters beneath as well. We may go there. I don't know if we need to go there, but there's dragons in your Bible. Do you know that? There's dragons. Anyway, well, there be dragons here. Anyway, so you've got the upper level that's there, but where is God in all of this? Is he in the heavens? He's above the heavens. So they didn't just have a three, like the Israelites, the Hebrews, did not just have a three-layered cosmology. They had a fourth layer that is all God. He's outside of his creation. He's the creator, and all of it is in his domain, including all of these other quote-unquote gods that populate the skies that all the other nations worship. Canaanites worship their deities, their sun gods and their, you know, tree gods and water gods and all of that. Okay, so God is the one who created them all. And so it's placing this idea of monotheism in its right perspective, not stripping away any other spiritual influences, but putting those spiritual influences in their right order in creation, created by the one true and living God, the God Most High, El Elyon, God Most High. So, yeah, you've got there in verse 5. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. See the same thing in 1:13. 1:13, just a page over in my Bible, verse 4. The Lord is high above all the nations, and his glory above the heavens, or above the skies. Go to 1:48, verse 13. Psalm 1:48, verse 13. In Psalms, sorry, these were all Psalms. 1:13, verse 4. Yeah, Psalm 108, verse 5, 1:13, verse 4, and 148, verse 13, excuse me. So Psalm 148, verse 13 says, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. Okay, so you hear that. His name alone, he's in a class all of his own. He's by himself. His name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. Okay, so we're not, as we talk about this, don't think for a minute that I'm trying to exalt these other spiritual beings into the place of the one true and living God. He is God alone. All other are created. And we'll get there in the New Testament if we get that far tonight. Okay? But I think it is imperative, it's so important that we understand and appreciate the spiritual for what it is. Because we live in a day and age where it is so easy for us to just kind of push all of that to the side and go, well, that's just the way they thought about things. But why is that dangerous? Why is it dangerous for us to go, oh, well, you know, Jesus casting out demons, he really didn't do that. He was just healing sicknesses. They just called them demons, and we don't need to talk about all that spiritual stuff. What's the danger there? We take away the miraculous? Yeah, the Bible says it. I mean, we call ourselves literalists. We're talking about the Bible and say that it's our authority. The Bible's full of supernatural ideas and thoughts, and so we can't just cut it out and do that. And if we cut out the other supernatural, what's to stop us from cutting out God himself? Because is he spiritual? Is he outside of our realm? Of course he is. And so if we cut out all the rest, then what stops us from going, well, you know, maybe the Bible's just telling us to be good people. It's just a moral book. And that's the liberal slide, right? That's that slide into just completely wiping the Bible off the table and saying, yeah, we can just be good folks. Yeah. Yeah, we now walk and live in the Spirit. We have spiritual new life. Like, what does that mean if there's no spiritual aspect here? And so I'm trying to, as we look at this, give us a frame of reference to understand some of these, honestly, kind of weird things to our mind and help you know that to the biblical authors, they weren't weird at all. It was just the way they thought about the universe and the world, and I think they had a better tap on reality, spiritual reality, than we do. Way better. Okay? So, are we good with he's above? He's above everything. I've got a bunch of other verses. You just look up above the heavens and you'll find that. Or enthroned above is another verse that you can look up, or a phrase you can look up and find other stuff that's there. Okay? So, all right, we'll look at the concept of monotheism. All right, so tonight I want to look at this idea of Elohim, and if we recognize that the Bible talks about other Elohim, who are they? Who are they? What are they? And I don't want to belabor this too much and stay on it too long, because we could easily have 6 weeks where we're talking about nothing, but hold on, let me write down all the different ones that I have, okay? Angels, demons, throne guards or cherubim, holy ones, watchers, sons of God, spirits, burning ones, serpents, burning serpents, that's seraphim, diabolos, or slanderers, adversaries, hasatan, another word for adversary, archos, rulers, exousias is powers and authorities, stoichion is elemental spirits, thronos is thrones, and then we have this whole other category of lords, kyrios. Kyrios is just lords. So many things that we can find in our Bible that talk about spiritual realities that are not the one true and living God. How do we wrestle with all these, and how do we keep them all straight in our head? It seems like there's a very diverse population of the spiritual world, just as there is a very diverse population of the physical world. Would we expect anything different from our creative God? He makes a world that is all his own. And it exalts him. That's its purpose. So, let's go. Where do I start? Where do we start with this? Go to Genesis chapter 6. Okay, we're just going to open up the can of worms here tonight with these other spiritual creatures in Genesis chapter 6, but we got a bunch of places to look. We're going there. We're going there. All right. Now, I will tell you out front, some of you may have Bible translations that avoid this. And in your footnotes, you'll see other things here as well. So, okay. So let's look at chapter 6, verse 1. So give me the lay of the land here. What's going on? This is pre-flood, right? This is just before the flood. You got down in verse 9, you're introduced to Noah. Okay, but verse 1 in chapter 6 gives us this kind of odd story that I think most of us in our Bible reading just kind of skimmed over and went, I have no idea what that's talking about, and we just kept going. Right? Are you there? I was there. I've been there a long time. Okay. When man began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, born to man, the sons of God, that is the Bene Ha Elohim, the sons, Bene, Ben is son, and Ha is the, and Elohim is gods. So the sons of the gods saw that the daughters of man were attractive, and the daughters of man is just daughters of Adam, mankind. Daughters of man were attractive, and they took as their wives any that they chose. Pause right there for a second. They saw that they were attractive, and they took. Does that remind you of any story that we've already seen in Scripture? Did one of the daughters of man see something as attractive and take it? Yeah, that fruit was pleasing to the eye. Ooh, good for wisdom. and she took it and ate of it. Right? There's parallelism going on here. We've got a fall story that's happening in Genesis chapter 3 with Adam and Eve, and we've got another fall story that's happening in Genesis chapter 6, but not with Adam and Eve, but with spiritual beings. And we don't get a whole lot. We don't get a lot of details on this, but it's there. Okay? So, they took as their wives any that they chose. Then the Lord said, "My spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh. His days shall be 120 years. A lot of people look at this and they're like, oh, you know, most folks don't live past 120. He's setting a date on mankind, and that's as long as they're going to get to live. And I think it's a pretty cool coincidence that most people don't tend to live past 120. I think the oldest person that we've been able to record was like 127 or something like that. But I don't think that this is what that's saying. 120 years. Let's kind of do the math, and you can see my spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh. His days shall be 120 years. What happens in chapter 7? The wiping out of mankind from the earth. He's saying, yeah, 120 years, I'm going to flood the earth. They got 120 years left. The corruption is just growing too much. It's not just mankind that's corrupted themselves. Now it's the heavenly beings that are leaving their appropriate place and coming down to be with men. And there's a whole lot of things here. We're not going to go into a whole bunch of detail, but think about what humanity lost as it left the garden. And we've talked about this in our Sunday school class and stuff about fall. Like, what did God say was going to happen when Adam and Eve ate of the fruit? You're going to die. You're going to die. And we think they did. Like, this wasn't some figurative, oh, someday you're going to die. No, they spiritually died. And so was this act here in Genesis chapter 6, and this is speculation, so I can kind of step away from the Bible, is this saying that the spiritual beings are somehow trying to reawaken a spiritual life that was lost when Adam and Eve left the garden? I don't know. But see what it says happens here. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days. And you're going, who are they? Who are the Nephilim? These are mighty men of old, giants, some have said. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of man, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. Okay, so pause for a second. If we look at ancient religions, you look at any of Israel's neighbors, the people that they worshiped, and I call them people because that's who they were in their stories. Read the Enuma Elish from Babylon, and you see the story of a god named Marduk, who's the sun god, who defeats the chaos dragon named Tiamat. And there's a god man, a demigod who shows up and wrestles bears and does all these amazing things. And he's a king, and he builds cities. He's a man of renown. He's a mighty man, a mighty warrior, like Nimrod that we see after the flood, a mighty hunter before the Lord. Okay? In the imagination of the ancient world, and I think reality here, this is a fusing of spiritual and human to make something that is what we might today call a mutant or a giant or a mighty warrior type figure. But think, well, we're familiar with this. Well, if you go to a Marvel movie, what do you see? You see Thor wearing his big cape and he's got his thing there. Well, guess what? Thor and Odin are actual deities in the Norse belief. Okay, but they were mighty human warriors who were given additional powers and abilities by the gods. And so they reached up higher than their normal state of being human and actually attained to godhood. Think about Pharaoh in the Egyptian mind. Pharaoh was worshipped as a god. He is a son of the gods. Okay, so they are speaking here about the realities that all of these other cultures around them are worshiping. They're worshiping these sons of God and worshiping these mighty men who became, you know, who populated the earth because of the union of a son of God and a daughter of man. Those were the ones that they worshiped. And where's our God? Where's Yahweh God in all of this? He's the one who sits above in judgment and is not going to allow this to abide and is going to sweep it away with the flood. Okay, so there's a judgment that is on top of this. It also kind of explains why we don't have a whole bunch of this happening right now. We don't have it running around because God did a pretty good job of wiping it out. And this really helps me when we get into Samuel, into Joshua, into Judges. Count how many times you see the word Rephaim in Judges. The Rephaim were there in the Canaanites. They needed to be wiped out. Why'd they need to be wiped out? Because they're this. They're this. Okay, there was a spiritual reality going on that God is not just judging, you know, peoples on the earth, not just judging groups of people and declaring that they should be, you know, wiped off the face of the earth because they're terrible and they're not my people. There is judgment over spiritual and physical sin that God is bringing justice through his people Israel by bringing them into the land to take it. Okay, so that helped me a lot with, because honestly, I read Joshua and Judges and you just see complete cities wiped out and it's just destruction. And that kind of hurts my heart a little bit. It's like, oh man, like I'm imagining the destruction and the gore and all of this. But when you recognize that this is God casting judgment down upon not just people who justly deserve it, right? We're all sinners. We all deserve the judgment of God. He's just in doing so. But when you add the spiritual layer on top of it, it makes more sense. It just gives a further level of, okay, I get why God is doing this now. Okay, again. So that's Genesis chapter 6. The Lord saw the wickedness of man was great on the earth. Every intention of his heart was evil continually. The Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, grieved him, and he said, I'll blot out man whom I have created from the face of the earth. Man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, okay, the things that populate the heavens. Mm-hmm, yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Og, king of Sihon, with his giant 13-foot iron bed. Well, after the flood, as you go through the table of nations, you end up coming to this dude named Nimrod. You come to Nimrod, and he is also, same thing here, these were the mighty men of old, the men of renown. He's referred to as a mighty man. And so, in the same way that Noah, when he got off the boat, what did he do? He sinned. In the same way, the spiritual beings, what do they continue to do? Sin. And so, sin continues. It continues on. I don't know. Who knows? Maybe there are. Maybe that's... We can get into some weird stuff there. Maybe there are... I don't know. I'll just say it this way. I believe there are spiritual realities at work beyond just the physical. And are there reasons why certain people have just a charm, a charisma, an ability to wield an audience, get power and money and do whatever they want to with it and grow in great abilities? And like we don't value warriors the way that we used to. What do we value today? Big investment bank accounts. When I say Warren Buffett, I'm not saying Warren Buffett is a Nephilim, but he could be. If you're watching Warren Buffett, I'm sorry. You can pay me off and I'll remove this from the internet. Sorry. But is it possible? I don't know. There are realities at work that are beyond me, but they're not beyond God. That's the point. He's the one above. He sees it all, and all will be judged in his time and in his way. So, does that answer your question? Thank you. We see them take on human form in other ways, right? You've got angels that show up in physical appearance. Yeah. That's a very nice way to say it. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. I know it's weird. I know it's weird. And it kind of squirms inside a little bit. It's like, ooh, are we really, is this in my Bible? And no, it's not. It's not the only interpretation. Yeah. It does. It does. Yeah. You may be entertaining angels unawares. Yeah. I can. So the other basic interpretation of this idea of sons of God is you will see it referred to as rulers sometimes. We're going to go over to Deuteronomy chapter 32 here in just a second. And there it's another place where some biblical scholars look at this and in my opinion, they are trying to protect God from this idea of polytheism. They're trying to protect God and say, well, we can't have this confusion of there being sons of God. And so they take the frame sons of God, which there are leaders of Israel who are referred to as sons of God. Like that happens. Okay, that's a thing. You see David called a son of God, right? He's, you know, so that's a definite thing that happens. But I don't think that's always the way that sons of God is meant. In this case, the clearest, most balanced way to look at the text is to read it at face value, which is to say that there are two sides being put together here. Daughters of man, daughters of Adam, and sons of the gods. And they had union, which created something other than normal humans that they give a name Nephilim to, which could be translated giants or other humans. Other things there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Through the Bible. And we can see that with the prohibitions against intermarrying that we see later on. And so I'm not saying that that's 100% wrong. I don't think that that is what we see here. And the reason why is because we see it other places. If it was just here and that was the only verse that we had, then I would be like, okay, you're probably right. Maybe I'm reading too much into this. But let's jump over. Like Genesis is the first book of the Torah. The fifth book of the Torah is Deuteronomy. They're telling the same story. They're mirrors of one another at both ends of the Torah. And so we see in the end of Deuteronomy a retelling. And it's in the Song of Moses. It's there in Deuteronomy 38. Did you have a thought before we turn there? In that case, why are the sons of Cain called the sons of God then? Our sons of God. And that, yeah. And so the daughters of men, daughters of Cain. But if that's the case, why not just come out and say it? Like the biblical authors could have easily said and had much more clarity in that, but they didn't. And I think there's some purpose to the euphemisms that are used as well. Yeah, yeah, you've got, you know, Goliath and others. Mm-hmm. Yeah, how does that come about? How do you have that when it's just, you know, sinful man and you know, or sinful woman and good man, whatever. How do you end up with kind of crazy, you know, physical feats and spiritual abilities and stuff like that? So, yeah. All right. So, yes, ma'am. That, yeah, and he gets that from it saying the Nephilim were in the world in those days and also afterward. It's like a, like he would say there's just a parenthesis around that statement. But why? We're going there. Yes, we're going there. That's where we're going after we get to Deuteronomy. Okay, so we're here looking in Deuteronomy chapter 32. This is the song of Moses. This is his kind of final word. He's writing the end of the book. He's come to the end, and he's now gonna sing this song over the people of Israel and tell them their whole story. Everything is there. Okay? And look in verse 8 of Deuteronomy chapter 32. This is fun. When the Most High gave to the nations their inheritance, when he divided mankind. All right, so pause there. When did God divide mankind? Think Genesis, Tower of Babel, back to Genesis chapter 11, right? The dividing of mankind. They were all together. They said, let's build a tower. Let's make a name for ourselves. And God said, let us go down and confuse their language. And that's what Babel means, is confusion. But he said, let us go down. That's another us that's there. What is who's this us? Is it the Trinity? Or are we talking about something different? Let's keep reading. When he divided mankind, he fixed the borders of the peoples according to the number of the sons of God. Now, you might see there's an asterisk or a little footnote that's there. The sons of Israel, yes. Okay, so there's a difference between Masoretic text and Dead Sea Scrolls and stuff. Israel is a fairly popular reading. And if you read this in the Septuagint, you'll say sons of the angels. It's a whole nother reading. So there's like three different readings that we have of this. The oldest manuscripts that we have of the Hebrew scriptures have this word Elohim, sons of Elohim. Textual variants come later on. What reason would a scribe or someone have of changing that from sons of God to sons of Israel? Why would somebody later on be like, you know what, I think I'm going to change this. That's kind of confusing. Yeah. And so, and if you're mapping it on to Genesis chapter 11, you're seeing, what do you see in chapter 10 of Genesis? You see the table of nations. You see all of the nations that are being listed out. And you're seeing that God is apportioning out all the nations and everything's there. And there's like 72 nations. And so it's saying, yeah, how many sons of Israel were there that went into exile down in, or that went into Egypt? 70. Okay, that was initially Jacob's sons were 70 that was there. And so they're trying to make this little comparison connection, I think, as they do that over to Genesis chapter 11. But again, I think it's a protection against this idea of quote-unquote polytheism, which we're not talking about. It's just because the scribes would have been writing much later as they're translating, as they're talking about the Qumran community there and the Dead Sea Scrolls, as you're talking about the Septuagint. This is thousands of years after it was originally written. And I believe they were trying to protect the sanctity of God as being alone and being the only power. And so they kind of said, we're going to adjust that God over to Israel. But what does that mean? What would it mean for God to fix the borders of all mankind, fix the borders of the peoples, according to the number of the sons of Israel? Like, does that mean there's only 70 nations and that one of the sons of Israel is assigned to each of those nations? Or is what we're talking about explained in verse 9? but the Lord's portion is His people, Jacob, His allotted heritage. So who is the God of Israel, of Jacob? It's Yahweh. He's the God of Israel. Who are the gods of all of these other nations? They are other spiritual beings, allotted to them, given to them to worship. You think I'm crazy there? Go over to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Allowing, yes, in the same way that He allowed Adam and Eve to sin. But in the initial purpose here, in the initial point, I don't believe that was the idea. I don't think God's going, I'm just going to hand you over to these false gods and you can worship them all you want to. But they are meant to rule beside Him, meant to be His divine counsel. Okay, and so that's the big word for the day, divine counsel. And I know I'm stretching everybody's brains here, but come with me. Come with me over to Psalm 82. Oh, yeah, Deuteronomy 4, sorry. We'll jump there really fast, and then we'll go to Psalm 82. Deuteronomy 4. Where's it at? Ah, here we go. Deuteronomy chapter 4, starting in 19. This is in Deuteronomy as Moses is like speaking to the people and telling them, you know, what to do once they enter the land he's been forgiven to enter. And as your title probably says, idolatry is forbidden. Well, it says, beware lest you raise your eyes to heaven. And when you see the sun and the moon and the stars, all the host of heaven, you know, the population of heaven, the spiritual beings there, when you see the host of heaven, you will be drawn away and bow down to them and serve them. Things that the Lord your God has allotted to all the peoples under the whole heaven. Okay? So within Deuteronomy, this idea that God gave the nations to be ruled by these other spiritual beings, but Jacob, Israel is His allotted portion. These are My chosen people called by My name. Right? That's right here, Deuteronomy 4, Deuteronomy 32 as well. Okay, so that, and don't think that this is like God saying, I don't want them. They're not, those people aren't Mine. He's saying, this would be like a mayor saying, maybe a mayor is not the best illustration, maybe a president. You got a president who says, all right, governors, you guys are going to have all these other states. I'm giving you the authority to rule and to lead these other states, but this province, this place, this District of Columbia, that's Mine. This is My portion. I will rule it, and they will be My chosen people. He rules over all of them, right? I mean, He is ruling them through another. Remember, the same way that Adam and Eve were told that they were going to rule. Like, you are going to rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. God placed Adam and Eve in this authority role in the garden and said, you're going to rule on My behalf. You're My image bearers. You're going to rule for Me. Does God need us to rule for Him? No. Does God need angels and principalities and powers and other deities? No. Does He choose to utilize them and us? That, yes. And I think it reveals something about the nature of God, that He is a God who wants to cooperate with His creation. And that says something amazing about our God, that He is completely other. He's holy. We just finished our talking on holiness, right? He's completely other, but He chooses to interact with, and not just interact with, but to actually give authority and rule and power to His creation. That's mind-blowing to me. Yeah, you got a thought? No. not as good as you would want it to be. But whenever you talk about Satan being the ruler of the power of the air in Ephesians 2, it's the same kind of idea that God has granted authority for a time to other powers that are underneath him but are above us. You know, what does Hebrews say? And Psalm 8 says that he created mankind a little lower than the heavenly beings, right? Little lower than the heavenly beings, than the heavenly host. That doesn't physically just mean that we're below the stars. It means that as far as authority goes, they do have authority over us. But what has he chosen to do with man? Exalt him above the heavenly hosts. Exalting in Adam. Can you imagine, have you ever asked the question, why is this snake showing up in the garden in Genesis chapter 3? What is this dude doing here? Why is he there? Could it be possibly that he's a little upset that God is choosing this second-rate mud creature over him? I was created first. I was more beautiful. I was created on the fourth day, not on the sixth day like that jerk. I'm going to come in there, I'm going to ruin things for him. All right, there's a jealousy and a pride that's at work here. And again, we don't get all of this. The veil has not been torn back so that we see the entire story. But I think there's enough that we can kind of piece together, enough that we can go, there's spiritual stuff at work here. There's a reason why he's an adversary. He's against us. And it's because he thinks he's better. Because he's firstborn and we're secondborn. Yeah. Maybe not the exact same, but in the same category. And that brings a good thing. So sons of God is an expression. Anytime you say that something is the son of blank, you're not necessarily meaning that it's progeny. That God, propagated and created these things. He did create, but not in a lineage way that way. Think of Elijah and Elisha. Okay? Thinking in their story, Elijah and Elisha, where you have these other prophets that started following them. What were those other prophets called? They were called the sons of the prophets. And that didn't mean that, Elijah and Elisha had kids and they followed them. They weren't their physical sons. It means that they were in the same category as them, that they're the sons of the prophets. They share a likeness with and follow along in likeness. So in the same way, the sons of God would be those who share a likeness with God in that they are both spiritual beings and who are meant to follow in his likeness and to image him, to glorify him. What was the command that the stars and the sun and the moon were supposed to do there on day 4? That they would rule over the day and rule over the night, that they would be there for signs and for seasons, and they had a purpose. But just as we sin, so also do spiritual beings and fall out of that. And so you have some that have fallen there and became other fallen spiritual beings. Shedim is another Hebrew word. It means lesser gods. Often gets translated demons. that would be there. But then can you have others that are obedient, like Michael and Gabriel, who are good, obedient sons of God who do what they're supposed to do and rule in the proper way. So, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he's talking to Greeks in that point. He's in Athens, and the Greeks had this whole pantheon of gods, and they worshipped so many different gods, and they all had their particular gods for their particular things. I think from the point of the Tower of Babel, God is prepared to say, "I'm going to have a remnant," like in. Remember, he's already destroyed everybody but one. And he's made a commitment in the covenant with Noah that he's not going to do that again. And so instead of when he gets to 11 and they're all congregating and building a tower to the sky, there's almost this like inkling that God's like, I'm just going to wipe them all out again. Nope. I made a commitment. I'm not going to do that. And so instead, I'm going to confuse them and I'm going to hand them over to these other rulers who will rule over them and they'll do good. I'm going to trust that they're going to do good. I'm going to believe that I've created them and they're going to want to image me and they're going to go forward and rule in my power and my authority. But they don't. Many of them don't. When you see gods like Molech and other Akkadian gods who call for the sacrifice of their children, you know, and God comes out against it and is like, I never even dreamed of that. I didn't even think of that happening. But it was in the mind of this other lesser being who left his proper place and went into the place that wasn't for him. So, all right, we are way out of time, but I'm going to put this here. I know, right? Time goes so fast when you're talking about weird stuff. But let me put this in your ear, a little bug in your ear, and let you play with it all week long. Okay, go to Psalm chapter 82. This was the passage that opened up a door for me that I had to go down. Because I'd probably read all of these different passages and just kind of skimmed over them and went, yeah, I'll figure that out when I get to heaven because I don't know what's being talked about there. It's there. But look at chapter 1 of Psalm 82, or verse 1 of Psalm 82. God has taken his place, taken his stand in the divine council. And already, like if you're a good monotheist, you're going, what's that? What's this divine council about, or the divine assembly, some translations may say. The assembly of the gods, literally, is what we're talking about here. Actually, the divine there is El. Yeah, it's just El. And then in the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. And this is where I was talking about, if you read, you know, you'll get a good split. If you go home and you pull up some Psalm 82 stuff online, you look at different commentaries, you look at stuff there, you'll see a pretty even split between folks that say, yeah, those sons of God right here, in the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. No, it's the midst of the judges. He's talking about the rulers of Israel. And so he takes his stand in the divine assembly. Ooh, that's kind of hard. We don't know what that means. Possibly it means that God is working along with man here. And so he stands in judgment over mankind. And he says, how long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? That's one side. The other side will take it at face value and say that God sits down in his divine war room, in his council meeting, boardroom, however, whatever image you want to come up with in your head there, that God is God. He is the one above all the gods. But he says, hey, I'd like a little input here. And particularly in this case, he says, hey, we need to talk about how you've been mishandling the people that I've given you. Remember, God's handed them over to these other gods, and they have mishandled. And so when you read Psalm 82, the simplest way, as you see God standing in the midst of all of these lesser gods, saying, it's time for your judgment. I'm going to judge you now. And saying, how long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. This is a command. This is a divine boardroom come to Jesus meeting, right? They're having a tough conversation about the mishandling of the universe in this way. Now, is it also probably talking about the mishandling of the leaders of Israel and the people of Israel? Yeah, because it's both the same role, right? The king of Israel was meant to rule and lead in a way that glorified God and gave him the utmost supremacy, and they were just stewards of his people. And in the same way, the spiritual beings are stewards of the nations and were supposed to lead them to him, but instead they claimed worship for themselves. Yeah. You're going ahead of me. Yes. Well, yeah, that's actually like this whole section. That's this whole section of my notes, and we haven't even gotten there. I decided to start in Genesis rather than 1 Kings. That's 1 Kings. We'll get there next week. Okay, so we opened up the can of worms of this divine counsel idea. We're going to look at it more next week as we go. Yeah. Same thing. Man, y'all are already on it. I love it that y'all are biblical scholars enough that I'm not like unearthing things you've never heard of. Like, you have the categories already for these stories. They're already there. I'm just hoping that you can look at them in a little bit different way to appreciate the spiritual realities that are there and not just shove them off to the side and think, oh, I need to not think about that. because honestly, it's freeing. It really is freeing to be able to talk about these things. And yes, do you get some weird looks from people if you start talking about them to you know, outsiders? And I wouldn't advise you going to, you know, the checkout line at at Walmart and being like, have you read Psalm 82 and about how God sits in the council of other gods and how he judges them and, you know, you're being ruled by other, you know, principalities and powers and doing that? I mean, it's all biblical language. It's all right there. But maybe that's not where we need to start, right? This is why we do this on Sunday night, right? You guys are the committed, the faithful, and we want to open up our Bibles. And like, there's a biblical scholar who talks about some of this stuff. He's an Old Testament guy named Michael Heiser, and he actually just passed away like 2 years ago. But he did a podcast called the Naked Bible Podcast, and he was just like, I just want to strip aside any of the, you know, other stuff that we kind of pile onto the Bible and just get to what it says. And so it's kind of fun to check out. He wrote a book called, The Unseen Realm. The Unseen Realm is the name of the book that he wrote, which is fantastic on all of this stuff. And it's got lots of footnotes and other scholarly authors and stuff as he's writing about it. So. Yeah, I mean, and it's crazy that Jesus had these conversations with, like, Nicodemus. And he's like, hey, Nicodemus, why are you thinking so physically about being reborn out of your mother's womb? Am I to enter my mother's womb and be born again? Like, come on, I'm not talking about physical stuff here, Nicodemus. I'm talking about being spiritually born. Do you see the wind when it blows around? Is that something you can just track with your eyes? No, there's more going on than what you can see with your eyes and taste with your tongue and feel with your hands. That's my third one. You did it again. So yeah, that is Daniel chapter 4, chapter 7, right in there. And you've got the watchers and all kinds of weird stuff that comes into Daniel. I mean, it's your namesake book, so you should be studying Daniel a whole lot. So, but yeah, fantastic stuff. And it's in a category all of its own because it's much, much later writing. And so it's taking a lot of these ideas that have been baking over time and then kind of plopping them down in this exile period. So it's very interesting as we look at it. But yeah, we're getting there. That'll be next week. So what are our verses for next week? We got 1 Kings 5:22. We've got coming into Job chapter 1. We got Daniel chapter 4 right there. You already have my outline done. Come in prepared and ready, and we'll have a good old time. All right. All right, let me pray for us as we close. Heavenly Father, we thank you. God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for a group of believers that love your word and want to be enriched and think about these things deeply and not just be on the surface with them, not just content with the status quo, but wanting to dive deeper and to understand your word better so that they might understand you better. That we can understand your plan and your purpose for us and your world to glorify you as the God above all gods, the God above all creation, the one who is enthroned in the heavens above the cherubim. God, we worship you and you alone. You are the only one worthy of worship and praise. And so we give you all of the praise and all of the honor in Jesus' name. Amen.